I am Femi Okay.
I'm Malika Bilal, and you're in the stream.
Today, we're kicking off a week-long look at the global impact of colonialism and how does colonialism shape the world that we actually live in?
And in what ways has it influenced your life? So many of you have already answered that question with hashtag BecauseColonialism, and I'll be sharing your responses throughout the week. So join our conversation on Twitter or live on YouTube.
I'm Payman Jaffery, historian at the University of Amsterdam, and you are in the stream.
By the early 19th century, a vast majority of the world's nations had been colonized by European powers. The empire building and resource-driven exploitation of states and their populations continue to influence the world today, from language, religion, and cultural beliefs to legal and economic systems. In certain countries, colonial practices included slavery, genocide, and the creation of political and ethnic divisions that remain to this day. Others have argued that Western colonization, in some instances, benefited colonized populations with the rule of law and also infrastructure.
So joining us to talk about colonialism's history and how it's remembered today, in Bangalore, India, Priyamvada Gopal, professor of English at the University of Cambridge. She's also the author of Insurgent Empire, Anti-Colonialism and British Descent. In the U.S. state of Indiana, Akin Adeshokan, an associate professor of comparative literature, cinema, and media studies at Indiana University. And in Lisbon, Portugal, Miguel de Barros, president of the Association of History Teachers in Portugal. Welcome all of you to the stream. I want to start with our community because they have so much to say. So I'll start with this tweet from someone whose handle is The Humble Milkmaid. They write, "Colonialism has affected my life because we still proudly use English names, because Wikipedia country entries start with European conquest as the first historical entry date, and because many people can't name 20 facts about their tribe of origin." So Priya, I'll turn to you with this because this is what you've studied, this is what you teach. This is a really big question to start with. How has colonialism impacted your life? But I wanna do just that. What would you give as your answer?
Well, I always begin my lectures of the year telling my students that I wouldn't be in that room if it wasn't for Lord Macaulay's 1835 minute, which created what he called a race of people, not English in blood and color, but in other ways. So English education in India was intended to create a class of interpreters between the colonial government and the vast Indian population. And I belong, my ancestors belong to that breed of people, as it were, English in every way but blood and color. So the very fact that I speak English and I'm speaking English to you now and that I teach English is intimately bound up with colonialism. And this is something I always insist my students understand when I'm in the room.
Miguel, I'm just thinking about how we think of ourselves in the world and somehow the influences of colonization still filter through, as Priya was discussing. You were born in Angola. Which was at the time, it was a colony of Portugal. So that makes you African as well as Portuguese. Do you feel African?
Yes. Not much, actually.
Uh-huh. Okay, so this concept of how do you think of yourself in the world from the Portuguese perspective, as a country that had colonies, how does that impact the way that you navigate the world, you think about the world?
Well, to begin with, as you said, I was born in Angola when it was a Portuguese colony. And that marked my existence for sure, because while I was there until I was 10, around 10, I didn't really realize how much in a segregated society I lived in. I mean, the official tale was that it wasn't a segregated society. And I only became conscious of these when I returned to Portugal in 1975, and later on studying in Portuguese schools, public schools, state schools, and having colleagues from Angola, Mozambique, from the former colonies, which in Angola itself I didn't have in school. So that says a lot about the system that was in place and how it shaped me. So my conscience of Portuguese colonialism and colonialism in general came later into my life, let's say.
What do you understand now that you didn't understand as a 10-year-old?
Well, to begin with, I didn't really question the way society was organized in Angola. So I didn't never questioned why we lived I lived in the center of Angola in a place that was called New Lisbon at the time and now is Huambo, which I suppose still is the second biggest city in Angola, or the second most important city in Angola. And actually, we lived in a white city. Only the servants were African, were black. I never questioned that. I never thought of it. I thought it was normal. When we traveled around, I saw the Africans in their the different tribes that constitute Angola, in their villages living their lives. And for me, it was like they made part of the landscape somehow. But it really didn't come to me that they were the real inhabitants of that place, if I'm making myself clear.
Very clear.
So I hear your story, and I want to share one more. This from a couple of people who mentioned this, one via tweet and one via video comment. So clearly people are on the same wavelength here. So this person today is on Twitter says, because colonialism still exists in the economic realm. So we're getting into specifics here. He writes, IMF and World Bank. And that's why many Africans risk their lives seeking a better life outside of the continent. Even though Africa is the richest continent in terms of resources, culture, history, and a dynamic population, you can see where this person's views are on that. But someone else picks up on that idea about the economic realm and seeing the legacy of colonialism there. This is Alden Young. He's an assistant professor at Princeton University. And here's what he told us.
The majority of private capital is allocated to the developed countries, Europe, North America, Japan. And then whatever small slither of capital is left, capital at the highest risk premium, is allocated to the former colonies. And I think this is reminiscent of the colonial mindset. In Sudan's case, one consequence of this is that Sudan's largest or most profitable export actually is the Sudanese people themselves, Sudan's human capital. The best of which is professionals and laborers go to Europe, North America, the Middle East, and are forced to work there to earn a living because of a lack of economic opportunities at home. This carries off and has many resonances with the experience of the 19th century of enslavement and then the colonial market.
Akin, a lot in there, but the economy, currency, what do you make of that?
Well, for me...
Akin, go ahead.
I was just going to say that is actually an angle I can take because for me, it's not so much British colonialism. Nigeria was colonized by the British as India was, as Uganda and Ghana was. But for me, growing up, I think it's the American colonialism, which is more of a cultural imperialism, media imperialism kind of perspective that actually spoke more directly to me, because by the time I came to a sense of myself as an individual, Nigeria was an independent country, so I really didn't have a colonial experience. I know from reading, from study, from history that Nigeria was a colony, and the fact that we speak English in Nigeria is a function of that. But I guess that for me, it is the fact that even as Nigeria was becoming independent, there was also this other dimension to the social space, which was dominated by American media. So my being in America, I don't know that it's directly a result of that, but I guess that part of the reason why we talk about colonialism today isn't so much, it is, of course, because of the colonial history, but also because something else has taken over, the American empire, the fact that empire is actually capitalism in practice. And so me being in America, the fact that people are going all over the world to look for ways of life, to find a better life, is a function of that.
Miguel, what were you going to say? Go ahead.
I can't remember anymore because it wasn't the beginning of the question.
That's what happens when we move on. Priya, you had something to add. Go ahead.
No, I just wanted to agree that one way in which we all share the legacy of the European empires, the age of empire, is that we, most of us, live in capitalist economies, and capitalism is very much tied up with the imperial project. And although it had very profound cultural and racial dimensions, you can't really understand colonialism without understanding capitalism. So even the sense that colonialism was in the past, I think is slightly misguided, because if you live in a capitalist economy, which most of the world does, then you are very directly every single day engaging with the legacy, the afterlife, as I prefer to call it, the afterlife, the ongoing life of colonialism, of the European imperial project. So I was just agreeing with Akin there that that is quite vital, and that in some ways the mantle of colonialism does shift from the European empires to America, but we also need to be attentive to the ways in which it is now shifting to parts of the post-colonial world, the ways in which Brazil, China, and India are starting to play a role as, you know, in some ways as colonizers involved in massive amounts of land appropriation and resource extraction.
I just want to add something to this conversation, and that is looking at the legacy of what European nations left behind in the developing world, and kind of judging that in terms of, was anything left behind that was positive? Have we built on something that's been a positive legacy? Something came to mind, and it's often used as an example, a humorous example, of what potentially could be a positive angle. I want to show you a little clip from a 1979 film called The Life of Brian. Have a look here on my laptop. It is called A Fine Study of Colonialism from this tweeter up here. And let me just play you 20 seconds or so. Have a listen.
Maybe the point. And what have they ever given us in return?
The aqueduct?
What?
The aqueduct.
Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and sanitation are two things the Romans have done.
And the roads.
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they?
Priya, so this is the idea that, yeah, they're terrible people, but they brought this, and it goes on and on and on and on. Priya, you go first, Miguel, you go second.
Well, it's the railways claim, right? So in Britain, if you raise the question of empire, people will say, yes, but the railways. Walter Rodney, the great Guyanan anti-colonial writer and campaigner, had a very good riposte to this. He said, you know, the British didn't build railways in Africa or India so that Africans and Indians could visit their friends. They did it as part of a resource extraction project. The railways in Africa invariably led to ports from which raw materials could be shipped out. In India, it was part of an administrative apparatus. So just because certain things got left behind and then they got used by the legatees of colonialism doesn't mean that they were done with the benefit of colonial subjects in mind. We have a tendency to take something that happened and make it positive, but that doesn't mean it was put there with a positive intention.
Miguel, go ahead.
Well, I just think that... Sorry?
Okay, go ahead, Miguel.
It's me
go
or
ahead.
Okay. Sorry. I was just going to say that comparison that you see there on Life of Brian with the Roman Empire is a bit unfair, because the Romans had their occupation and then colonization spread over a long period. And also they didn't have the means that European nations had in the 19th century. So the colonization of the 19th century was much faster and much more brutal from my point of view. And also the other point I wanted to just to talk about was about the, you talked about Brazil, and I think Brazil is a very good case of a country where the decolonization still has to be done inside Brazil, because there is obviously in Brazil a very obvious division between the European people that descend from Europeans and the others, and it's very structural there. And I think a lot of these Latin American countries are a very good example of something in halfway between the two ideas of colonialism. And unfortunately, now I think you have in Brazil a government that is on the side, on the, let's say, put it that way, on the European side of things.
The other thing I would like to add, I mean, I agree with these two points. I would also like to add that, in fact, colonialism isn't the one that actually built all the railways and the roads and the sanitation. It is modernity. And the Indian writer Ashish Nandi, in his book, The Intimate Enemy, actually says that modernity is the liberal side of colonialism, that colonialism is the military wing. So colonialism brought colonial violence, but there was also something going on, which was that the world, including European nations everywhere, okay, had to become modern, had to have this idea of being an individual, which was not even there in Europe to start with. So in fact, the idea is not so much that colonialism brought modernity, but that it was impossible for colonialism itself to operate. And I guess that that's the point of the argument, the reference that Priya drew from Walter Rodney. And there's a Nigerian philosopher, Olufemi Taiwo, in his book, How Colonialism Preempted Modernity in Africa, who argues that, in fact, prior to colonialism, that there were African religious figures who actually were already becoming modern, who actually were trying to do those things that colonialism, in fact, that what colonialism did was to sidetrack those people. So as a matter of fact, there was already in West Africa, for instance, a deliberate attempt to become modern by Africans. Okay, former slaves, yeah, of course, but yeah. Africans.
Well, one of the things that we've lost.
Priya, before you jump in, because I want to give you something, Priya, because our community, I would say, agrees with most of you on this point, but there are a few people who raise the counter-argument, and so I want to pose this to you. This first person says, as we discuss this legacy of colonialism, please consider voices from Ethiopia and Liberia. I was shocked when my Ethiopian pal wished that they were also colonized to benefit from DEVCOM, i.e. infrastructure, that the British did, after she stepped foot in Nairobi. So that's one person's perspective. Here's another.
Is really interesting because, in fact, a lot of anti-colonialists organized around the invasion of Ethiopia in 1835. Ethiopia is very beloved in a kind of pan-African context because it was the only non-colonized African nation, and Haile Selassie stood up to the European powers, and Ethiopian independence and Ethiopians' very zealous guarding of its independence inspired anti-colonial struggles across the world. I think it's a really kind of fatuous idea that you needed colonialism in order to bring infrastructure and development. Yes. I mean, if you think that it's fine to have massive amounts of land expropriation as Kenya did, and massive amounts of bloodshed and exploitation in order to get a couple of airports and railways, that seems like an extraordinary price to have to pay. As Akin was saying a few minutes ago, there were tendencies in lots of cultures to head in good directions, in interesting directions, and all of those possibilities have now been lost to us. And we all believe this notion that only through Europe could we have arrived at good things. How do we know what was lost? How do we know where the world might have gone, where Ethiopia might have gone without the intervention of Europe in the form of the Italian invasion? And subsequently, it was prey, like many parts of the world were, to European influence.
I like that you raised how will we know, how would we know, of course, because in hindsight, who knows? But I wanted to share this because you saw this on your screens just a minute ago. So I want to share this because it's another person with that perspective. That guy says colonialism brought a lot of development in the colonies. The white man should have stayed for 100 years more in the colonies. For instance, in 24 years, the black man has been in charge in South Africa. It's been full of corruption and it has yielded another form of segregation, xenophobia. And people online believe this, but I would love to hear your response. What would you tell them? You're a professor. How would you then educate them?
Well, I mean, I think one thing to say is this, that colonialism relied on corruption. It relied on local elites in India. It relied on local elites in parts of Africa. And what has happened, and C.L.R. James, the great Caribbean writer, explains this, that what happened is that when England or France or Belgium pulled out of Asian and African countries, it's those collaborating corrupt elites who ended up taking over. And colonialism didn't just disappear. I mean, you know, all former colonial powers continued to have huge stakes in their former colonies. And neo-colonialism is something that we haven't talked about very much, the ways in which colonialism continued in certain ways with the help of local elites. So, you know, talking about white men and black men, I mean, first of all, that is outright racist, but also it's just, it bears no resemblance to how history actually operated. And it seems to me extraordinary that people can talk still in racial terms as though the white man was somehow genetically equipped to make the world a better place. I mean, what is the argument here?
As a matter of fact, South Africa is operating in a capitalist system, a very exploitative system. The man who is the president of South Africa now, maybe now he has divested himself, but up to 2012, when the Marikana crisis happened, he was an investor and actually a board member of one of the mining companies. So, I mean, what does race matter when there's capitalism? So, as a matter of fact, as people argue, whatever you call race is a function of race of capitalism itself. So it's not surprising that that's going on in South Africa, it's going on in Nigeria, it's going on in India.
Miguel, I want to get you in because this is really important. I actually want to go to the job that you do as a teacher, because you are looking at the education system in Portugal and looking at how colonialism has been taught and wanting to shake that up a little bit. I feel that would be a good place for us to wrap up our conversation in. How do you teach colonialism to a country, to a nation that used to have colonies?
Well, that's a big issue. Actually, it's a big issue right now, because we are on the last 3 years on the process of changing the curricula and trying to make it more open to this kind of discussions instead of having a more closed narrative. And the matter of the fact is that I don't think it's an issue with history teachers, because I think most of them are actually quite well prepared to teach in this new way, let's say. But there is a large part of the society and a lot of people from my age and older, and from 45 to, let's say, 70 and plus, that were taught a certain tale, a certain narrative. And for them, it's really, really very difficult to suddenly to come to terms with the fact that come to terms with the fact that colonialism had an ugly face. And for most of them, actually, they refuse it plainly, and they just go into the defensive and say, oh, we haven't done anything good, we haven't left anything good, so all the Portuguese colonial history is just an history of massacres and slavery and suffering. No, because, and then they come, they say, no, we need to fight these, we need to fight back. But the reality is that I think just the fact that this discussion is in the open is a very good thing, because let's say that until 15 years ago, we wouldn't even discuss these issues. The narrative was there and we wouldn't even think of it. And we would just consider that that was...
It's such a
truth.
Big chunk of history, Miguel, that it's kind of hard to avoid talking about. You have to talk about it at some point. Thank you for helping us talk about it today. It's got our whole series off to a really interesting start. Malika?
I'll end with this tweet from someone who explains why we should learn about it. Reno says, learning about colonialism through reading, research, and life experience has helped shape my curiosity about the world, my constant striving for knowledge on the origins of wealth, inequality, and power.
Thank you to Priya, to Akin, and also to Miguel for discussing colonialism. Such a huge topic, but we managed to drill it down and really give some excellent examples. We continue with our conversation on Tuesday as we continue with our special week of shows on colonialism. Could the pain and trauma of colonialism be genetically inherited? We'll look at the debate amongst scientists. Thanks for watching. Malika and I will see you online.